Thank you, Laura Lynn. Welcome to St. James United Methodist Church. Today is July 5th, and it's the fifth Sunday after Pentecost. My name is Mike Stevens, and I'm your liturgist today. I'd also like to introduce you to the rest of the worship team today. Our pastor, Dot Donita Lee, Alan Jones is our music director, and Laura Lynn Christensen is our accompanist. Regarding announcements, when you go out to make your offering and your tithe online, you can certainly go out to the website and check anything that's on the calendar there for announcements. Also be following us on Facebook, and that will keep you up to date with what's going on. So please do that and watch for our next newsletter.
Great, thank you, Mike. As we begin this service today, many of you have learned our gathering prayer, and I encourage you to get the candle that you may have selected. And we will begin by speaking our gathering together as we light our Christ candle. Several of you have asked me in emails and texts, and Dot, why is it that we're doing this gathering prayer? And I can tell you very simply, it's a way to bring us together and to acknowledge the Christ light without acolytes in the room. So we look forward to the time when our acolytes will be back with us and can light our Christ candles for us. And in the meantime, I encourage you to pray this prayer with me. I tell you the truth. There was a man who said amazing things, and he did marvelous things, such that the people began to follow him, but they didn't know who he was. So they had to ask him. And one day when they asked him, he said, "I am the light." And the light is with us today. The light will guide us, and the light will reveal truth.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us in worship. Our opening hymn is In His Time. Let's all sing together.
He makes all things beautiful.
And now if you'll join me for our affirmation of faith, we'll be reciting the Apostles' Creed from our hymnal, page 881. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now it's time for Church Chat.
That's right. Welcome to Church Chat, where we are like many of those other late night talk show hosts, but we're here to encourage you to be holy. So we're continuing to broadcast here during COVID-19 from Church Lady Studio, which, yes, I must remind you, used to be my jazzercise studio when I was more worried about taking care of myself, you know, sweating to the hymns. Well, today we've got a special occasion for you. We're going to be meeting with a friend of mine who I met when she was finishing seminary a summer ago. She is a pastor at a little church in Texas, and we're going to talk to her about what she's been doing in COVID-19 and what that congregation of hers is going to be doing soon with COVID-19. Well, as I said, we're going to be meeting with a friend of mine who's a minister at a church somewhere in Texas. So let me introduce you to my friend, Reverend Danita Lee. Now, Danita, or may I call you Dot?
Of course, call me Dot. That's what you called me at school when we were in seminary together.
Yes, but since we were at seminary, things have changed a little bit. I've moved on to large church bodies doing these presentations with Church Chat, and you're in a local congregation. So why don't you tell me something about your congregation and how y'all have been dealing with this COVID-19?
All right. Well, it's so good to see you, Church Lady, as always. Our church is a United Methodist Church. We're St. James United Methodist Church. We're in Abilene, Texas. And we have been dealing with the COVID, I guess, by the grace of God is what I need to say.
Because, well, isn't that special for all of us?
Yes. We have just been trying to adapt and accommodate best we can to keep everyone safe. So we've had several services online. We stream with YouTube. I know you're familiar with that in your publicity.
A little bit with YouTube.
Yes, yes. And so we've been streamlining our services there. And then we've had some meetings on Zoom, like we're meeting today. And we've had a few gatherings of small groups in our church.
Well, very good. So how has COVID-19 really hurt you as a church?
Well, I don't know that it has hurt our church. Matter of fact, it's been a blessing in some ways that while we're not able to meet in the building, we've been able to do some construction in our sanctuary to improve and expand and brighten and just make all kinds of improvements there through our priority campaign. So that's been good. You know, it has been a challenge though to make those changes and adapting, and nobody likes being at home by themselves without getting to see their friends and our church family, and that's been hard. And of course, no hugs and no Wednesday night meals where we get to just fellowship together. So that's been a little tough.
It does put a damper on that fellowship, doesn't it? Well, Dot, now let me ask you, does your church, does your congregation have any plans on getting back to normal?
I don't know what normal is anymore. We do have plans to reopen our building and come back to worship on July the 12th. That is our current plan.
That's coming up very quickly. How are you going to be able to do this? Are you just going to open the doors and willy-nilly allow everybody to come back in? Carrying that COVID bug?
Well, we're prayerful that people will not be carrying the COVID bug when they come back, and it won't be willy-nilly by any means. We are going to follow protocols that we've set up, and the protocols are by the guidance of the CDC, our Governor Abbott of Texas, and our local mayor, Mayor Anthony Williams. And we are considering the concerns of our church family. So we're making all the precautions that we can to keep people as safe and healthy as we can.
Well, that's good to hear. So what are you going to be doing now that there's this surge? Because I've been reading the news. I'm careful about which news I read because so much of it is just so bad. And we want to keep filling our minds with the godly. But I understand that there is a surge of the virus there in Texas. So how are you dealing with that? And how are you going to do that as you open your door? Are you just going to let anybody in?
Well, we know God invites all to come and worship, but we're going to do it with wisdom. We have a pre-screen that we're going to use, and we have a thermometer we'll use. It doesn't even touch the skin. It's an infrared, and we'll open only one entrance. It'll be on the Shepherd Street side under our new portico where there's a bench, and we'll be very quick. Our greeters are going to help with the screening, and then the ushers are going to help people come in and find their seat.
Well, now, I've been in a few United Methodist churches. You people really like your fellowship and sitting close to each other and hugging each other and giving each other the right hand of fellowship. How are you going to do that with social distancing?
Oh, gosh, it has been such a challenge, and we have discussed this. We've had several ad council meetings. It's not just my decision, but the decision of the group. And we are going to have the usher seat the individual so families can sit together, shoulder to shoulder. We'll sit the next person at least 4 feet over so that there will be a safe distance there. We're sitting on every other pew so that we're not very close together in distance. And then we have an overflow area that we're going to use in our fellowship hall with some live streaming of our YouTube service. And we'll be sitting 4 to a table there.
Well, now, what about those people? And we have them in all of our churches. We even have them in mine that have their special place that they like to sit. Will they be able to call ahead and reserve that? Or will they just have to find someplace else to sit?
No reservations allowed. We are just going to sit where we are asked to sit during this time. And then there will be a day, I strongly believe, that we won't have the restrictions of where we sit, and we can go back to those spots, or maybe we'll find we have a new favorite.
Very good. Well, now let me ask you. I know from our time together that you love church music. What are you going to do about a choir? Because, you know, when they sing, they just tend to spew bugs out of their mouths. What are you going to do with your choir?
Well, everyone is asked to wear a mask. Everyone will be asked to use hand sanitization as well as our social distancing, even the choir members. And at first, we're not going to have the choir members in a special seating. We're just going to have solos, maybe duets or quartet for special music. And we'll just sing as a congregation with our music director, Alan Jones, leading us. We hope that will be really fun. And for those who don't feel comfortable singing with the mask, well, they can just tap their foot and maybe do a little church lady dance.
That would be nice. I would love to see that sometime. So is the choir going to sit up in the choir loft, or will you have some other special accommodation for them?
That's a good question, and I appreciate that. We are sitting in our families. So when the choir member comes with their family, they'll be seated with their family. And we will be using the choir loft as some overflow seating with some of our choir family members. But again, we have to practice the safe distancing there too. So it will be that we skip a row, we'll seat the back row and the front row.
That sounds very good. That's very special, Dot. Well, now let me ask you, are you going to be enforcing things like hand washing? Because I know sometimes people get a little bit excited as they go to church and they just do the cursory running the hands under the water, and they pray to the Holy Spirit that he'll keep them pure.
Well, that's one way to approach hand sanitization, but we're going to go a little further because we believe God also gives us wisdom and common sense. So we will be giving everyone hand sanitizer when they come in the door. And then we have the soap dispenser in our bathrooms where they will also be encouraged to wash their hands if they have not done so.
Well, now I've got to ask another question, Dot. Okay. I know that as a Methodist church, you people love visiting. I know, I've been there. And sometimes it's hard to clear out the sanctuary because people just want to congregate and give that right hand of fellowship. Are you just going to let people stand there, or how are you going to do that to keep that social distancing going?
Well, we do love to congregate, don't we, church lady? We do love to hug and spend time together and get caught up with one another, and there will certainly be that temptation. However, we're going to have to do that outside, not inside the building. We're not going to be gathering and grouping inside. Rather, our ushers are going to dismiss us at the end of the service, one row at a time, and we'll ask that folks just go ahead and make their way out to the parking lot. They can stand under the portico if they want to, where there's shade, maybe under one of our trees, and the children will be brought to them from children's church, so there'll be no need to go up and down the halls. We'll be able to just move directly outside. Once they're outside, if they want to visit, that's entirely up to them, but we can't get into tight groups within the building. We have to keep that distance there still.
Got to keep that social distancing going. That's good. Well, now, you and I agree on one thing. Holy Communion is extremely important. How are you going to do that in this age of social distancing and COVID-19?
Well, you're so right. We do agree on that. And I miss Holy Communion. I miss it so much. And I've heard others miss it too. So we are going to serve Holy Communion. We'll begin our first time to serve Holy Communion will be in August, the first Sunday in August. And at that time, all of our, all the people that volunteer, all of our church members that volunteer to prepare communion will have gone through a training, and we will use every precaution. We'll be wearing masks and gloves to serve. We'll have people come up and receive their gift of bread and receive a cup. We'll have, instead of dipping into a cup for intention, we will actually have people be handed a little plastic cup out of our tray that we've used some in the past, so that they will be able to receive that. And then the third person in line that they will encounter will be holding a basket or a little trash bag where they can drop their cups after they're finished. That way no one has to have contact and our communion is protected. And then there's one thing, church lady, that we learned in seminary that I'd like to share with others. And that's when we ask God to consecrate our elements, we know God will protect us from receiving those elements.
Yes, he does, because he cares for us deeply. Now, Dot,
yes.
I've got to ask you a couple of more things, because okay. I know as Methodists, besides the right hand of fellowship, you like having those forks in the right hand and sharing a meal together. I know Methodists love to eat because I have had more than my fair share of green bean casserole. So how are you going to handle eating together at church?
Well, we do love the green bean casserole. And how about that jello salad? We're good with that too.
I've had a little bit too much of that during COVID-19. I think I've got a COVID-19 spread going now.
I think we all have a little bit of that going on. But we are planning our first meal together to be July the 15th. That's the first Wednesday after we reopen the building on the 12th. We're going to have two dining times, so two sessions. And we ask people to call and make their reservation for the time they prefer. And during that time, when they come into the building, they'll be screened again, just like on Sunday morning. They'll be given hand sanitization, asked a few questions. Then they'll make their way down the long hallway to the fellowship hall, and we'll have it marked off where they can stand so that we're maintaining that distance we need to keep. And volunteers will be seating them. So the volunteer will be wearing masks and gloves. The people coming in, we just ask that you wear your mask until you're seated to receive your food. And after you're seated, there'll be another volunteer bringing the food to you at your place. We can't have any open containers, so the drinks will be bottled water, bottled tea, maybe some sodas. And the first night back, we're going to have hamburgers with some French fries and ice cream for dessert. And the ice cream's going to be wrapped and all the condiments will be sealed and wrapped and we'll be very safe, but it'll still be really good food.
That sounds good. Where do I call to make a reservation?
Oh, I would love to have you come, church lady, if you could come join us. We just to call the church office, that number's 325-692-0263. You can let Elaine know which of the times you'd prefer to come.
I'll have to check my schedule and see if there's any flights. Well, now okay. Let me ask about one other very important thing, Dot. I know okay. Education is important. How will you be holding Sunday school?
Oh, good question. We've asked a lot about that. We just weren't sure how to do Sunday school. So we took a survey and people said predominantly they would prefer just to wait and not have Sunday school until we get a full green light that we can just come back into the room without those precautions that are needed right now. So for a time being, and we don't know exactly how long, we are not having Sunday school before church. We'll just come and be prepared for our worship service at 10 o'clock.
Now, Dot, I'm concerned. You've been talking about the physical food, but we've got to have our spiritual food for our congregation. You're not just going to let them fast and starve, are you?
Oh, heavens, no. We currently have our Tuesday lunch bunch still meeting, and we're actually opened up with a hybrid gathering, if you will. You can come into the building and join us at lunch bunch on Tuesday at noon, or you can join us by Zoom. We're still providing Zoom for that time and gathering. We're also putting together a Bible study that will be online, and we're making all of those decisions right now. We'll let everybody know as soon as we have it up and running.
Sounds like you're taking care of your congregation. I am so glad for you on that. Well, it certainly seems like you've got everything in order and you don't have to worry about, who could it be? Satan? But do you have anything else you want to let us know before we leave?
Well, I do want to say it's just so important that when we come back together, it's going to be a little bit awkward. It's going to be a little bit unusual. And yet we can make it fun. We can have a time where we come together and we're still going to be worshiping together, maybe just a few extra feet apart. And we're still going to be praying and we're going to come forward in bold faith and we're going to step forward in faith and know that this too shall work because God will guide it and God will make a way. We're promised that.
Well, Dot, it certainly has been special talking with you tonight. I hope you have a wonderful reopening to your church, and I hope to see you again really, really soon.
I hope so too, church lady. Thanks. It's great to see you.
Well, God bless you, and God bless your church.
Let's continue to worship together as we sing America the Beautiful.
Thy alabaster seal.
perfect it is that we sing America the Beautiful today on this, our July 4th celebration weekend. And as we come into celebration, we want to join our hearts not only for our patriotism, but in our faith, we also join our hearts in prayer. As part of our prayer for this month of July, because we will very prayerfully be coming back together in the building for worship, we're going to say the Lord's Prayer each Sunday for July during this time. The Lord's Prayer is probably the most familiar prayer throughout our world, spoken by many denominations and several different faiths as well. And so it makes for a prayer that we are comfortable with, that we know as our tradition, that we can say together. And I ask that wherever you are this morning, that you join me as I pray the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Testament reading this morning is from Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 24 through 28, and then Isaiah 43:19. Ezekiel 36. I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove from you, from your body, the heart of stone, and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, and make you follow my statutes, and be careful to observe my ordinances. Then you shall live in the land that I gave to your ancestors, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. And then Isaiah 43. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. This is God's word.
Thanks be to God.
I will sing of thy Redeemer.
Our gospel reading this morning is from Luke chapter 22, verses 7 through 13, and then verses 19 through 22. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us, that we may eat it." They asked him, "Where do you want us to make preparations for it?" "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there." So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But see, the one who betrays me is with me, and his hand is on the table. For the Son of Man is going as it has been determined, but woe to that one by whom he is betrayed." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And today's New Testament reading is found in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned." This is God's word.
Thanks be to God. Our sermon today is a sermon of celebration and a sermon of reflection. It is a time when we prepare for the new thing that God is designing for us and our lives. I know if I say the words "once upon a time," you will know that I'm immediately going to begin a fairy tale or a story. Similarly, if I say "ready, set, go," you know that I'm leading you into either a race or an opportunity to jump into the swimming pool or an opportunity to play a game. It's the introduction and it's that starting point that we all have that is equal, if you will. Ready, set, go. Some of us count down 3, 2, 1, and we start. Well, that's usually our sign, if you will, our sign that something new is about to start, something new is about to happen. And how exciting that we come today on July 5th, preparing at this time for a new thing to happen in our lives. Our lives here at St. James United Methodist Church, our individual lives in relationship with God and one another. So what is this new thing I'm talking about? Anybody have an idea? Well, I think it's pretty evident. Mike is raising his hand. He knows. It's pretty evident, according to all that we are publishing, that next week, unless there are great changes in what's taking place with our COVID virus, next week, July 12th, we're re-entering the building for our worship service. I am so excited. I'm so ready. And I'm cautious as well, which is why we're following all of the guidelines that are presented to us, not only by CDC, but by Governor Abbott, by our mayor here in town, Mayor Anthony Williams, and in consideration of all of the members at St. James. You've seen that written several places. It's on our website, but it's important that we know we're not randomly choosing this action that we are taking. It's been planned, it's been prayed over, it's been prayed for, it has been discussed ad nauseum. It has been every amount of planning and preparation we can make to make this as smooth a transition as possible. And so with that, you'll find the guidelines that the church lady and I talked about just a little while ago. The guidelines to help make this doable, make it easy, and keep us all safe as we eagerly come back to worship together at St. James. In light of that, though, there's some other newness I want to talk about, another new thing. When you come back into the sanctuary, it will look new. So much has been done through the priority campaign and the monies that you have given faithfully to expand and improve our church, and our sanctuary looks fantastic. I'm so excited and I can hardly wait for you to see it. Everything from our air conditioning and heating being completely reformatted and realigned from underground to up in the attic, and new units, and the air quality will be so much better, but it will also be much more energy efficient, and we will be good stewards with the resources we've been given. We've got new flooring. We have all the pews have been sturdied and re-glued and refinished, and they don't wobble, and you can sit and pull yourself up if you need to, and you'll be safe to do so. We have, did I mention new flooring again? I keep saying that because it's so pretty. You're going to love it. There's just been so much that's taken place, and if it were not for your giving and your faith in the continuance of this church family and the continuance of this ministry here in Abilene, Texas, as the body of Christ we call St. James United Methodist Church, these new beginnings would not be happening. So thank you. Thank you for your faith. Thank you for your gifts. And thank you for your perseverance. You know, we have new doors as a part of our refinishing and remodel, not just in the sanctuary. There's new doors at the office and new doors in our foyer. But I hope there are new doors on our hearts as well. Because if we cannot open our hearts to receive the gifts that God has given us and to go outside of the building to continue being the church, then we've missed the mark of what it means to be the body of Christ, the church, those called by name to serve God, to worship and praise God, to connect with our community and to serve those in need. And I know you, St. James. I know how giving and trusting you are. And I cannot wait to continue serving with you in this expanded way. So with that, I want to talk a little bit about all this newness. Oh, my glands. I mean, some of us are so excited about the word new. Others of us hearing the word new, we just kind of clench our jaw and tighten our fist. And we think, prepare for the unknown. And with that, I'm going to address our faith. You know, there is the scripture that Mike read just a moment ago, Isaiah 43:19. I absolutely love that scripture. And the verse 18 that comes right before it says this: forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. And then it goes into the verse 19. See, I am doing a new thing. This is God speaking. This is God's promise. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? Do you not see it? This new thing that God is offering us, this new beginning, this new opportunity that God is giving as a gift, that we might reflect on how to be the church in a new and improved way. Now, this scripture that I just quoted says, forget the past, forget all that we've ever done. And I think in regard to what I'm talking about, that's a little bit out of context. So I want to clarify that part. Of course, when we come back into the building to worship and to celebrate God together, we won't be forgetting our traditions. We will not be letting go of those deep roots of our faith and those deep practices of sacrament and praise and singing and reading of scripture. In that regard, you're going to feel like it's very traditional and very known to you. We're going to, as I mentioned earlier, we'll be using our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. It's something that we have claimed throughout our history of Christianity. It is also that we're going to be praying the Lord's Prayer. You don't get more traditional than that. So don't worry. I'll use an old West Texas phrase here. We're not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. We're keeping those things that we know to be true and proven and essential for our faith and our relationship with God and one another. However, we are going to start some new things. What would they be? I know you're asking yourself, well, maybe I don't want to do that new thing, Dot. Maybe I don't like that new thing that you're presenting. I can hear church ladies saying that again. Well, isn't that special? But what we know is that God has given us an amazing opportunity. Some of us haven't really seen it that way. Well, maybe none of us have really seen it that way until we were able to kind of catch our balance, take a deep breath, and say, okay, Lord, now that there's been this change, now that we've been sheltering in place, been away from the building, taking precautions and using extra distance between us, literally, how do we reflect on our faith? How do we spend more intentional time with you in study, in prayer? How do we reflect on our spiritual disciplines? I know I've talked about those a few times. I'm going to keep talking about them. These are the gifts God has given us that allows us privately and on our own, separated and distanced from others, as well as in community and in common, that we can practice, make routine for us, make a habit. I hate to say habit because I think habit is something that is just a repeated behavior without much meaning behind it. So I don't want to use habit. Let's change that word. Here I am about changing something else. But let's say ritual, that we make a ritual in our lives, something that's very meaningful. These spiritual disciplines that we can continue to practice at home, at work, on our own, and as we come together for worship. And let's have these spiritual disciplines be laden and just coated with meaning of value for us. And the way that we can claim that value is to claim the promises of God, to get to know God, to understand who God is. And we've talked a lot about being bold in our praise, being bold in our discipleship, being bold in our study, being bold in our silence. Can you believe I even preached be bold in silence? Oh, me of all people. Just showing that God can work miracles and still works miracles in our lives every day, every moment of every day, if you will pay attention. If I will pay attention, look for the miracle God has for us. Look for the new beginning, because this is a new beginning for us. We can come together as St. James United Methodist Church within our building, yes, a refreshed, a renewed building, and a new time to come back into worship. But more importantly, church, how do we want to come back as the body of Christ? What have we learned in our time of silence and quiet? What have we been experiencing in our discipleship, in our service, in our mission work? What is it that we know God is calling us to do now as we step forward boldly in faith for this new season, this new adventure of the church, this new possibility of being the church? What does that look like? How will it unfold? And who will be involved? And who will say, I'm not ready yet? And who will be eager and say, let's step forward together. Let's unite in our purpose of proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let us unite in our service to others, those who are hungry, those who are needing safe sanctuary, a place that they can call home, a place that they can call worship, a place where they know they will not be threatened. And how will we come together and unite in offering a voice for those whose voices have been quieted, who need advocates, not for political gain? This isn't about politics. This is about our holy word and the promise of God, that we are all God's children, and we are made by the same heavenly God, and we are loved equally, none greater and none less. There is no privilege among us outside of our faith that is given to us through the grace, through the mercy, through the perfect love, and through the forgiveness that's offered through Jesus Christ, who came to be the fulfillment of God's promise to each of us. We've heard those promises in our scripture this morning. We've heard of them in our Old Testament as we've been studying the covenant, how God revealed the covenant. And as we learned of that covenant being revealed through Ezekiel, we also learned through Isaiah. As God promised us, God's people, God's children, the body of Christ, that we are one. And that God calls us not to a country, but to the kingdom of God, where we are all equal, we are all free, and we are all given privilege. There are so many right now in our community, in our country, in our state, in the world, that are in desperate need. They're in need from just the basics to survive living. There are so many that are desperate for hope. They're desperate for another way to live. They're desperate for true freedom through Jesus Christ. And if we don't tell them that they can find that through Christ, how will they know? If we don't step forward boldly as the body of Christ, boldly coming together as the church, St. James United Methodist Church, or if we don't come together boldly as the United Methodist Church to proclaim this, or if we don't come together boldly as Christians to proclaim Christ as our Savior and our ultimate freedom, if we don't claim that and if we don't profess it and if we don't live it, how will others receive the gift that we've been given? Not out of our privilege, not because we're entitled. Heaven knows none of us are worthy. But because of God's love and passion for each of us. So church, it's a new day. It's a new time. And it's a grand opportunity to come together and to be the church. I am so ready to see you next week. I can't stand it. And I am so eager for us to worship together in person. But until then, know this. The Holy Spirit unites us wherever we are, and there is no distance known as we come together as the body of Christ. By the power of Holy Spirit, may it be so. Amen.
Bow with me in prayer. Accept this offering, O God, as a token of our earnest desire to be responsible stewards, an expression of our love for you, and a sign of our willingness to be of even greater service in the future. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just a closer walk with thee. Would you join us as we sing together?
I am weak, but thou art strong.
Joining your hearts together with mine today as we worship, as we praise God, as we laughed with Church Lady, and as we cringed a bit when the Holy Spirit convicted us with Scripture, and as we heard from the teachings, next week is a new beginning for us. So this week, I ask that you take that step forward with prayer. Ask God to guide, to lead, to bring us together, to weave us together with love and grace. And that we would see God's direction and God's will for our next steps forward. And may they be bold steps of faith. Then one day, this light that was with us, this our Christ, changed, but did not leave us alone. Instead, offered us Holy Spirit, the true breath of God, the Spirit of God that resides within us. And in knowing that, may we go forward being reminded that God is for us. God is with us. God is within us. Amen.